This is Jeremiah Blocker. You're up early. I suppose if you want to get up this early, there are worse things to do than listen to my friend Scott Grant, the Scott Grant Show on 103.9 FM WSOS.
Hi, this is Scott Grant, and I'm here today with Jennifer Price and Andrew Nagorski. And I got to tell you, Andrew, you're the most accomplished guest that we've had on the show so far. So we're really thrilled to have you here. Thanks for coming.
Thank you, Scott. A pleasure.
And now I was looking, you you worked for Newsweek for many years, and Newsweek was a big publication for decades. I mean, a very important publication. What was that like? Tell us about working for Newsweek.
It was a great run. I was there for more than 30 years. Most of that was in the field as a foreign correspondent. I was in places like Hong Kong, Moscow, Rome, Berlin, Bonn, Warsaw. So it was at a time when, as you say, Newsweek was a very powerful news organization. It had a circulation of several million, and it meant that you had a real editorial operation that was very professional. Didn't always get everything right, but you felt it was committed to good reporting, good writing. It was a great training ground for a young journalist like me when I started, and then once you were in the field, you were able to go basically anywhere you needed to for a story, and there were times, they of course had financial constraints, but if there was a big story, for instance, one of my first foreign assignments was Hong Kong, and at that point, this was 1978-79, the big story was Vietnamese boat people washing up on the east coast of Malaysia. I get to Kuala Lumpur. I realize the only way I'm going to get the East Coast in time to file anything is to charter a small plane. And that's what I did. And they didn't blink. These days, if you tried to do that, you'd be fired.
The budgets are that much thinner, huh?
And the budgets are thinner. Newsweek no longer exists. I mean, there is a Newsweek, but it's been sold twice at the time. And it's a pale shadow of what it once was. So, I mean, there's the whole crisis of journalism since then that we can talk about at any point if you want to, but it's I just feel lucky to have been there when editorial operations I felt were committed to providing their staffers, whether they were editors or foreign correspondents or domestic correspondents, with the tools to do their job as best they could.
You know, and when I think about that era, I picture a bunch of you guys, let's say in Hong Kong, all in Hong Kong at the same time. There's the AP guy and the UPI guy and the guy from Time and New York Times. Is that what it was like?
It was. It was very much in Hong Kong, as I say. It was my first assignment. And remember, this was British Hong Kong still before it became, was handed back to China. So it was this interesting mixture of a British colonial setting with a Chinese population and culture. But it was a regional base. And when I arrived there in 1978, it was also a place where, remember, the Vietnam War had ended in 1975. So there were a lot of correspondents who'd been there for a long, who had covered Vietnam, who were sort of these
veterans.
Hardened veterans. And I was the new kid on the block, felt kind of intimidated by this. And but it was a base for all of Asia. I was a roving correspondent, and I got to go everywhere from Japan to Southeast Asia to Australia.
Oh, that's really great. And I think, you know, the opportunity to travel, I'm thinking about it. But back to China and being the new kid on the block, are there some names, were there famous names that you encountered during that period that you know, from the journalism?
Well, there were a number of correspondents who probably don't resonate very much these days, but I'm trying to remember. They were, at the time, the counterpart at Time was a man by the name of Marsh Clark. That the New York Times, there was Fox Butterfield. There was.
I remember both those names.
You do. Love that name. That
Fox Butterfield.
Yeah, that was character of a novel.
Yeah, that was like a classic New York Times byline. Fox Butterfield. There's something so preppy about that,
yeah, definitely preppy for sure. And but cool. I mean, and you know, you kind of want to read that. What's Fox got to say today? Fox Butterfield
and Jay Matthews of the Washington Post, who was a good friend, who's and his wife Linda Matthews was the Los Angeles Times correspondent. So it was funny. Later on, there was another marriage in Hong Kong where, after I had left, where the Newsweek correspondent was a woman by the name of Dorinda Elliott, who was a colleague of mine, and her husband, Adi Ignatius, was the Time correspondent. So Dinda, as she was called, would say that at times you get these calls in Hong Kong because of the time difference around midnight, where she was discussing stories and she had to kick her husband out of bed so that he didn't overhear the story about what Newsweek was planning to do that week.
That sounds like such an adventurous relationship, like a Mr. and Mrs. Smith.
Yes. Yeah, well, I think it was a little different in character, but I get the point.
And so were there... Oh, wait, we got to take a break. So let's do that, and we'll come back, and we will talk more with Andrew Nagorski.
Hi, this is Grace Della Rosa, and welcome to the Scott Grant Show on 103.9 FM WSOS. It's been a hard day's night, and I've been working like a dog. It's been a hard day's night, I've been sleeping like a log. But when I get on to you, I find the things that you do make me feel alright.
Thank you. words in black and white.
Hi, this is Scott Grant. I'm here with Jennifer Price and Andrew Nagorski. And we're thrilled to have you, Andrew. I got to tell you again that you're the best guest so far.
Thank you. What, have you had two guests so far?
No, I think it's we're up to seven or eight, actually.
He's also the first guest that's razzed you like that.
That's true, too. I liked it. Before the break, we're talking about, you know, being a journalist overseas, and we were talking about Hong Kong. What would it be, you were talking about how at that time, you know, there were guys from all these the wire services and the various newspapers and magazines, and you were all there, and you all knew you were there, probably staying in the same hotel in a lot of cases, right?
In many cases, yes, which, and especially when they were more dictatorial societies like South Korea at the time, all the rooms seemed to be on one line, which you knew that they had mic'd every room up and down that line.
Oh, that's interesting. That's really interesting. So would it be different today? I mean, similar or different?
Well, first of all, the number of foreign correspondents would be different for the most part, and the size of the bureaus, for instance. In those days, the networks, the ABC, CBS, NBC, each would have big bureaus, hub bureaus, whether it was Hong Kong, Tokyo, and huge crews that would go out. So everybody's had cutbacks. The number of full-time correspondents has gone down. There are, though, some new journalistic institutions that have come up, and so I don't want to say it's by no means a wasteland, but many news organizations rely more on stringers who are freelancers who don't have the benefits of being staff or just paid for whatever work they do. I know
a number. We know a number of those people here in this area. There's a bunch of them. You know, and they're putting together, you know, a little short story, and if they can get it on the air, they get paid.
Yeah.
And so they'll show up at some of our events, some of the history stuff we're doing, and, you know, I'm always hoping they get it on the air, and they're always hoping they get on the air, so I'm trying to give them good stuff, but it doesn't always make the air. I do know that.
Yeah, but even when you're staff, it doesn't always make the air, as you know, or your story, if you're writing for a newspaper or a magazine, sometimes you get on, but there's a much better chance if you are staff to lobby your editors, make sure it actually gets aired or printed or on a website. So, you know, I think these days the community is very different. It's just everyone is a little more, there wouldn't be the same size of a foreign correspondence community, and there wouldn't be generally the resources behind it to go anywhere, do anything. Some news organizations still have a pretty decent budget, but though it's a limited number.
Do you think that these budget cuts fueled sensationalism?
Well, I think what happens in journalism is as the whole economic model, the advertising that had flowed into a smaller number of news organizations before cable television and then, of course, the web, meant that they were the advertising was concentrated on a far smaller number of news organizations who therefore had the resources to really hire and train journalists in a way that is rarely done now.
You guys were like special agents.
Well, some governments accused us of being special agents. What? I was kicked out of the Soviet Union, for instance, but I wasn't accused of being a special agent. They just didn't like my stories.
Oh, okay.
did
journalists ever, I should say, did spies ever pose as journalists, do you think?
That was certainly true at times, but for a long time, even, for instance, the CIA had a rule that was imposed, I don't remember exactly what year, saying we will not use journalists as cover anymore. I mean, that didn't mean that there weren't times that journalists get suspected of using cover, but it is official U.S. policy not to do that. Other societies, it may be different.
Yeah, you know, it's funny. I asked the question, and I was immediately thought of the Civil War. And I think during the Civil War, I don't know if it was Grant or Sherman, but one of those guys, had all the journalists kicked out of camp or locked up because he said they were all spies.
Yeah, well, that's the natural instinct of many political, military, other leaders in a high-stress situation like a civil war to view journalists from who are not immediately working for you as, often they are identified as spies.
Do you view any particular journalist that started the movement of being almost undercover as an agent? Stetson Kennedy?
I would have to go back and look at that. There was a famous case uncovered in the 40s or the 50s, Whitaker Chambers, who wrote for Time, was an editor for Time magazine, who had been a communist agent for real. This was not McCarthy era fantasy, but then he turned and then fingered others, and it became, and this was played into the whole McCarthy era and the whole
accusation. And he was a Soviet spy. Whitaker
he was
Chambers.
A Soviet spy. The Soviets had a very extensive and network, the best spy in history, probably. Actually, your question was a Soviet spy in Japan during World War II, who I write about in my book 1941. His name was Richard Sorge. He was an incredible guy, posing as a German correspondent. He had a German father and Russian mother. So he moved freely in both society, posed as pro-Nazi and so forth, while he was spying for the Soviet Union.
Ooh, that's good.
That is good. I got to write that name down. We got to take a break. We'll be back, and then we'll talk about your current writing projects.
If you want to know what's going on in Northeast Florida, Jacksonville, and St. Augustine yesterday, today, and tomorrow, tune in to Scott Grant at 103.9. He's got all the latest and the best history we've got.
What?
Hi, this is Scott Grant. I'm here with Jennifer Price and Andrew Nagorski, and we're recording our show today in the Standfast Studios in beautiful downtown Ponte Vedra Beach. Andrew, it's great to have you. We have a couple things in common. We both love history, and we were both born in Edinburgh, and we neither of us stayed in Edinburgh long enough to get an accent. That's correct, right?
That is correct. It's for me, it was a fluke of history that I was born there, and maybe also accounts for my interest in World War II and so forth. My whole family came from Poland originally. My parents grew up in Poland, and my father was called up in 1939 when the war broke out in the Polish army, and Germany invaded Poland to start World War II. Poland resisted, fought for a month, but they were overwhelmed by the superior German forces and firepower. And then he managed to escape, eventually make his way to Polish forces that were regrouping in France. And when France fell, then to England, and then to Scotland, where he was with a Polish paratrooper unit based in Scotland. That later was involved in action in after D-Day. He at that point had already become actually a Polish war correspondent for the Polish army. So I get my journalism a little bit from there.
Yeah, you get it. Yeah. You come by it naturally.
Yeah, and then they stayed for a couple of years after the war in Scotland. There was no going back to Poland. Poland had become a communist country, and my grandfather had been in the government in exile, which was the anti-communist government in London. So I was born in Scotland. My name is Andrew because St. Andrew, the patron saint of Scotland, but because, just like you, my Scottish accent is a little faint because I left when I was 10 months old and we got on the Queen Mary and came to the United States.
Well, it's interesting. My name is Scott because I was born in Scotland and because I have a cousin who's about 6 months older who they named Andrew. And so my parents were a little dismayed that they didn't get to name me Andrew. So I'm really close to being Andrew Grant, but I have a cousin named Andrew Grant. So you're in journalism. You get out of journalism, you become a historian, and you write books, and a lot about World War II. And I think you just told us it was the personal connection that led you to want to write about World War II.
In part, not simply. I mean, that obviously, growing up, I heard a lot of stories about World War II. There are people come through our house who had been in the war, and the Polish underground, and various other stories. But it really was then when I was a journalist, I after going to Hong Kong, I spent most of my career in Moscow. I was in Germany twice. I was in Warsaw and Italy. And the problem, the questions of World War II kept coming back. I originally not set out to write books about World War II, but thinking there's so many great books and great authors who've written about it. But then I realized there are more and more of these stories, and I actually started writing some books when I was still working for Newsweek, and then I gradually moved to saying, I want to do this full-time. It's really hard to do with your left hand write books and right hand do your day job, that's what I ended up doing, and now I've written 7 books, and five of them relate to World War II.
Right, and I know the most recent book is 1941, the year Germany lost the war, and I've spent some time reading portion of Hitlerland, which fascinated me, and then you also wrote a Nazi Hunter book. Is that what it's called?
Yeah, it's called The Nazi Hunters. Yeah. Very, very straightforward.
Which is, I think, a fascinating story, and I think a lot of people would love to hear it. I'm actually more interested in the other two. Let's talk about 1941, the year Germany lost the war. I've heard this thesis, I think. Also, people talk about 1942 being the year of decision. And then, you know, again, 1940, particularly, I think, the Battle of Britain being, you know, another lost opportunity. But why is 1941 specifically the year that Germany lost the war?
Yeah, and some people would say 1943, 42, 43, Stalingrad, the big battle, and so forth. But the more I've written now books before about the before and after and during, And the more, and I'm always interested, I was interested as a journalist, what's the pivotal moment and what are the personal decisions? These books are full of personal stories about both the people on the ground and the leaders. And in this book, 1941, there's a reason there are these four faces on the cover: Hitler, Stalin, Churchill, Roosevelt. I argue that that was the year which basically changed everything. If you look at the beginning of the of 1941, at that point, Britain is still alone. Churchill is there still alone. Hitler has basically taken over most of the continent, and the Soviet Union, Stalin, is still in a pact with him and supplying Hitler with all sorts of things. The United States is still officially out of the war, although Roosevelt is sympathetic and beginning to talk about supplying more to Britain. And so, and Japan is not yet in the war. And so, so it looks like Hitler is convinced he's going to win. And a lot of people in the West believe he's going to win. By the end of the year, what's happened, Hitler has invaded the Soviet Union. Japan has struck Pearl Harbor in December. And suddenly, the Allies, it's not just Britain, it's the Soviet Union, the United States, and Britain. And their resources, even though Hitler's still, and the German army is very powerful, their resources cannot be a match for the Allies.
For the other three.
For the other three in the long term.
All right, let's take a break. We'll come back. We'll talk more about 1941.
Wow, you're up early. This is Scott Schobrock, and you are listening to my good friend Scott Grant on 103.9 FM WSOS.
Coming up!
Hi, this is Scott Grant. You're listening to Scott Grant Show. I'm here with Jennifer Price and Andrew Nagorski, author of 1941, The Year Germany Lost the War. And we were talking beforehand about, you know, the events that lead up to that. And you said that you liked getting inside the mind of some of the German leaders, including Adolf Hitler. You know, what were they thinking? So let's go through some more of those mistakes from 1941, particularly relating to, you know, the turn to the East.
Yeah. I mean, if you think again about Hitler's position at the beginning of 1941, he has control of much of continental Europe, and Stalin is doing his bidding. He's sending him supplies and so forth under the terms of the Nazi-Soviet pact. But Hitler always had it in his mind that you have that in the end there's going to be a German empire to the east, where all these Slavic, what he called subhuman people live, and the Jews, who he's going to exterminate. And this was defied logic. This was an article of faith. And so, and the other thing about Hitler was he was a compulsive gambler. So when things went well, suddenly he had managed to score all these victories. All his neighbors had been defeated, and especially with the culmination of the defeat of France. And then he thought he could intimidate England and make it sue for peace on his terms. When Churchill refused to do that, he said, well, the only reason Churchill is refusing, the British are still fighting, is they think that eventually the Soviet Union will come in as an ally because they can't hold out alone. So I'll turn around and take care of the Soviet Union now. So he escalates. He's got this compulsive mentality that he's got to, everything, something goes well, he escalates. Everything, something goes badly, he escalates.
And you think he does it on both sides?
He does it on both sides.
I guess the bulge is sort of an example of that. You know, they're getting defeated in France, and he counterattacks.
Yeah, by the end of the war, by the end of the year, he makes all sorts of mistakes. At first, things are going well in the Soviet Union. His troops move in quickly, but he delayed for all sorts of reasons, diverting troops to the Balkans, and then he delays the assault on Moscow until it's too late, and they get bogged down. And then by the end of the year, his troops are getting bogged down, so Japan bombs Pearl Harbor, and Roosevelt declares war on Japan, asks Congress for a declaration of war in Japan. The U.S. has still not declared war on Germany, so what does Hitler do? He declares war on the U.S., because he says, okay, this next escalation is really going to help, because the U.S. has been helping Britain by this time. And part of the story of the book is how Churchill and Roosevelt are getting closer together, and all these supplies under Lend-Lease the Americans are sending. He says, now the U.S. will get sucked into the Pacific, and they won't be able to keep supplying Britain, and they won't be able to keep supplying the Soviet Union, because once the Soviet Union was attacked, we, the U.S., began helping the Soviet Union as well.
Yeah, that's right. We do. We add them to the Lend-Lease as well. I mean, I think that's one of those questions that fascinates people. I mean, why does Hitler declare war? I mean, we don't declare war. In fact, I think you know, Churchill declares war. England declares war on Japan before we do. He's, you know, ecstatic. This is one of the greatest things that's happened to him. Mm-hmm. And then Germany declares war on the United States. And I don't think at that point we've yet to declare war on Japan. We're still waiting for
Congress. No, we have declared war on Japan on December 8th, right after Pearl Harbor. But then Churchill, then it's a three-day pause before Hitler declares war on the U.S. By that time, Roosevelt knew that we'd be in war with Germany, too. And after all, Germany and Japan and Italy have this tripartite pact, but it's still interesting that Hitler manages to convince himself that this is good news for Germany.
And do you think he saw everything as good news?
Well, later on he becomes increasingly troubled by things, but at least in this whole rush to, one German writer wrote, basically 1941 was the year Germany declared war, attacked the world. You know, basically. Oh, yeah. So, and if you attack the whole world, eventually things are not going to come out so well for you, even if you built up a powerful army. And there were all sorts of other reasons, of course, his policy of terror in the East and so forth.
I remember people talking about, and I saw this again the other day, but talking about this idea that Hitler and the Germans should have come into Eastern Europe as liberators, as opposed to, conquerors. Is that, I mean, is that kind of what you're saying?
I think, yeah, I describe in the book, for instance, how some people in Ukraine and Belarus and the borderlands of the Soviet Union at first welcomed the German army, not because they knew anything about Hitler, about the Nazis, what they stood for. They thought, but they had been terrorized by Stalin, who was a mass murderer on at that point a bigger mass murderer than Hitler. He had starved his people. He had had mass executions and so forth. So they thought anybody's got to be better than this guy. But what does Hitler do? He doesn't even pretend for a moment that they're liberating them. Instead, they immediately start terrorizing them and killing people on a massive scale. And it's not also incidental that 1941 is the year when the Holocaust begins
in earnest.
He sends in these killing squads of the Soviet Union that kill mostly Jews, but some others as well. And so this policy of mass murder and terror goes hand in hand with in 1941, and immediately makes it easier for Stalin to rally his own people, even though many of his own people have been incredibly oppressed by him.
Wow. You know, we got to take a break. Jennifer's giving me the sign. We will be back after some music and talk more with Andrew Nagorski.
Hi, this is photographer Lenny Foster of St. Augustine and Gallery 144, and I'm here on the Scott Grant Show, WSOS 103.9, St. Augustine Radio.
Where it began, I can't begin to knowin', but then I know it's growing strong. Wasn't the spring, and spring became the summer. Who'd have believed you'd come along? Touching hands, reaching out, touching me, touching you. Don't seem so lonely. We fill it up with only two. And when I hurt, hurting runs off my shoulders. How can I hurt when holding you? Touching warm, reaching out, touching me, touching you.
Hi, this is Scott Grant. I'm here with Jennifer Price and Andrew Nagorski, author of 1941, The Year Germany Lost the War, and a number of other books. And I've read some of your work, and you're a really good writer. You remind me of William Shire.
Wow. That I blush, and thank you. That's a comparison that I certainly like if it's at all true.
Just the style and the reference, the cadence. There was a lot of things. It reminded me of Shire, and I told you I was gonna say something about you that you'd like, and that's a good one.
Just did.
That's a good one. So you're talking about 1941 and the mistakes. Do you feel that that Moscow should have been the target?
Well, if you were invading the Soviet Union, as if that was your goal, I mean, there are many people, and I get into this again, that who, even within Hitler's apparatus, some of his economists and others said, you know, this is really a risky venture. You shouldn't undertake it to begin with. But if you're going to do it, especially the generals, the top generals were saying, take Moscow. That's the nerve center. That's the political center. That's where all the logistics runs in communication center. But Hitler, for instance, he knew that Napoleon in 129 years before had sent his armies into Russia, and they had then gotten caught in the Russian winter and in trying to take they took Moscow, but the Russians fled and burned Moscow, and then the Napoleonic army was totally destroyed in the Russian winter. He said, I'm not going to let that happen. I have a more modern army. But he kept showing some ambivalence about Moscow, and he, at the last moment, he diverted his troops south to the Ukraine, to Kiev. They fought that battle, that delayed it, and sure enough, by that time, his troops were caught in first the fall rains and muddy roads, and then in freezing cold. Even by Russian standards, it was a tough winter.
Yeah, it was a tough winter. I remember this. That's one of the stories. And it was in, what is it, 1813?
1812. That he moved in.
The 1812 overture. I should know that.
Yeah, 1812. And Hitler was so confident of a quick victory that he sent his army in without winter uniforms. I mean, it's just colossal mistake. Just like Stalin made colossal mistakes, he thought he could keep Hitler at bay, that keep this alliance going longer, and his troops weren't ready. So both dictators almost were in a competition. Who could be the more stupid dictator in this situation?
I can see that. I mean, and Stalin makes some mistakes, for sure, but in the end, their industrial production ramps up to a level that challenges Germany, plus with American lend-lease, and the Soviets push back. What did they get, about 90 miles from Moscow? Is that?
They even got closer at some of the advance units. There were some advance units that claim, there were claims that some of the Germans' advance units could actually, through binoculars, see the spires of the Kremlin. I'm not sure that's exactly right, but they were awfully close, but they were all awfully thinned out by that time. But the Russians didn't know how. Yeah, they thought Moscow was going to fall. They were evacuating Moscow. They even evacuated Lenin's body from Red Square.
Didn't know that one.
Yeah, it's an incredible story. And I several years ago in Moscow, I managed to interview the son of the person who first embalmed Lenin's body and then helped escort the body in the summer of 1941 out of Moscow, because Stalin thought if they not only capture Moscow but they capture Lenin, the symbolism of that is just
symbolic victory is huge. Mm-hmm. I always sort of thought that the Germans would have been better trying to take Leningrad, or what we now call St. Petersburg, because it was closer and because it was on the coast. And but it's interesting to hear you say, no, you think that they were right, that was where they should be going.
It would have been a huge, much bigger psychological and practical blow, I think, to take Moscow. And they were within striking distance. They failed because of Hitler's mistakes. But, of course, what does Hitler do? He fires his generals and blames them, the same generals who had told him to use different tactics and take Moscow first. And that's the one other difference with Stalin. Stalin actually begins to learn a little bit from his mistakes, despite all the things he did wrong. And eventually he becomes the smarter military leader than Hitler was.
And Hitler, I don't think, was ever a great military leader, but he was successful. I mean, he did things, they worked. That's got to boost your confidence. Everybody tells you you can't take the Rhineland, you can't take Czechoslovakia, you can't take Norway, you can't take France. You do take all those places after everybody's told you can't. Then they tell you can't take Moscow, and you say, well,
watch me.
I like that.
exactly. And even those, some of the people within his government and some of the generals who had been advising him not to do all those things began to think, well, maybe this guy knows something we don't. Maybe he is as infallible as he presents himself to be.
I'm sure there were believers. We're going to break in a second, but before we do, I just want to ask you, of the books that you've written, what's your favorite?
Oh, that's a tough one. I tell you,
Because after that, I want to know what your favorite child is.
Yeah, exactly. I say it's very comparable. My favorite right now is 1941, the year Germany lost the war. But I also, each one I can talk about differently. But I think Hitlerland, about the perspective of Americans in Germany in the 20s and 30s, and how you watch history unfold, how different it is at the time than in retrospect. The Nazi hunters. So, I mean, I'll go with 1941 because I got to choose one, but it's a tough choice.
Okay. All right, let's take a break, and we will be back with Andrew Nagorski.
Hi, this is Dr. Arun Galani, and you're listening to the Scott Grant Show on 103.9 WSOS FM.
Hi, this is Scott Grant. I'm here with Jennifer Price and Andrew Nagorski, author of a number of books about World War II. And before the break, we were talking about World War II. And in this segment, I thought we'd talk a little bit more about journalism and what's currently going on in the world and get your – you've got a lot of experience. Get your take on that.
Well, before any more heavy history, because that was pretty heavy, I want to know more about your watch.
Well, Jennifer, that's you're wise for spotting it. Not everybody, it has, just for your listeners, it has a dial. This is actually an Israeli watch. It's Hebrew lettering, which I learned, having been in Israel, that the letters also represent numbers. And I was invited to Jerusalem to give a talk earlier this year to one of their groups about the book Hitlerland. They were very interested, of course, for obvious reasons, about the rise of Hitler and a new perspective on that period and the psychology of the times. And it was very nice to be invited. It was a very high level group. And at the end of it, they presented me with this watch, which I found to be very attractive. And I had to have it explained exactly how these figures go. It also, it says on it, Adi. Now, within my family, my nickname from my sister, who couldn't pronounce my full name in Polish, because when I was growing up, my parents were still speaking Polish at home, It was Andre, and she shortened it to Adi and said, how did you know about my nickname? I heard the Mossad was good, but... And they said, no, that's the name of the company. And actually, it's a very popular Israeli name, too, which is something I learned later.
Oh, that is fascinating. And, you know, the Adi, when you say Adi as a name, the guy I immediately think of is Adolf Dassler, who called himself Adi.
Yeah, Adolf often gets changed to Adi, and including the other more famous, infamous Adolf, too, was sometimes referred to.
Did they call him Adi? I didn't know
occasionally,
that.
Occasionally, later on, not. That's something is a less pleasant association.
Well, I know one of your books, you talk about the 36 Olympics, and I bring up Adi Dassler because Adolf and Rudolf Dassler had a shoe company, and they made shoes for Jesse Owens in 1936 in the Olympics. And this is kind of the first celebrity shoe endorsement. After the war, they have a falling out. And Adi, and they form separate companies. Adi calls his Adidas, or Adidas. And Rudolph calls his Puma.
Yeah.
So that's always a story I just liked. I had to throw that out. We're talking about Adolf Hitler, Nazis. It's a common thing these days, in this divisive political climate, to accuse the other side of being Nazis, right? And it bugs me a lot, because I think it minimizes this tragedy from the 1940s. And as much as you may not like a politician, you know, calling that politician Adolf Hitler sort of overstates it. What are your thoughts on that?
I have the exact same reaction, and I began to get questions on that, and it wasn't only in the immediate current era, current administration, where this came up. When Hitlerland came up, I think I published this in 2012, I believe. And so this was long before Trump became president. And there were still people getting up and saying, isn't what's happening in the United States, and depending on whoever whichever side of the political divide you were on, just like what happened in Germany in the 30s, isn't this the Weimar Republic? Isn't this the Hitler era? And I would say, and I say today, when this sort of stuff is invoked, or concentration camps on the Mexican border, whatever you think of how we handle people coming across the border, to equate that with the concentration camps that Hitler had, or to equate a current politician or group of politicians with fascism, concentration camps in the 30s, is trivializing Hitler, the Nazi Party, the Holocaust, everything else. So whatever you do, argue the case on its merits. You can have whatever opinion you want. But these kinds of really, really sloppy historical analogies, they're only meant to basically stop any discussion. Because once you call someone a fascist, or as are in the McCarthy era, when people called somebody a communist who was not a communist, it ended all debate. You've identified that person as evil, so why even discuss things with them? We have a society, whatever its flaws, where we should be able to debate honestly, where we should have be able to have differences without this kind of invective. And I think that really contributes to the sort of decline of political discourse in this country, and I think a lot of it's not just one side at fault.
No, I agree. I don't think it is just one side.
And now we're hearing journalists themselves use such sensational descriptions.
Yeah. Well, I think getting back to the problem of journalism is, as journalism became more fractured and more desperate, frankly, news organizations to keep readers or viewers or listeners, because the way of basically supporting a journalistic institution fell apart, there's this tendency to preach to the converted. And there's also a tendency not to have people who are trained journalists to really go out and let the reporting dictate the analysis, but to just have people who state opinions and then cherry pick whatever's alleged facts to support their opinions. And that again is not, and then you have this balkanization of journalism and of their audiences.
I'd like to hear a class. Have you ever been a professor?
I have taught classes. Yeah, I taught a class on international affairs writing at Bard College. Had a program in New York City. I moved here from New York.
Ask you, how long have you been? You're in St. Augustine
in
now.
St. Augustine.
You're a St. Augustiner. And how long have you been here?
We moved in the summer of 2015. So it's 4.5 years now.
And it's great down here. You like it?
Oh, I love it. I love it. And as soon as I realize now I can leave my last day job and really do this full time, write these books and my freelance pieces, why would I want to stay there? And we've never looked back. I still go back to meet my editor and do various events. But every
time,
it's
fun to visit up there.
It's fun to visit. I am now very happy to be here.
I'm a big fan of visiting. We've got to go. We're out of time. Thanks for being here, Andrew. You are a wonderful guest.
Well, thank you. I really enjoyed talking to both of you.
Lovely to meet you.
Thank you.
The Scott Grant Show is brought to you by Standfast Asset Management of Ponte Vedra Beach, Florida. Standfast is a fiduciary asset manager specializing in great American companies. We're proud of our disciplined approach to investing.